everyone, welcome back to my channel. If you're new here, my name is Caitlin. I upload a whole bunch of different types of videos on this channel, mainly surrounding true crime and psychological cases, as well as a little bit of university and lifestyle sprinkled in where I can. Now today I'm going to be discussing the case of Michael NEGRETE. I apologise if I mispronounce the names at any point. As always, I'm useless at pronouncing names and places. Just how it is. And the usual disclaimer, there will always be one in the description, but I'm not trying to offend anyone. If I get anything wrong, mispronounce anything like I said, I'm not trying to offend anyone or do anyone an injustice. I'm here just kind of for educational purposes, I guess, displaying information that I have found myself on the internet, so I apologise if anything goes wrong. Michael William NEGRETE was born on March 25th, 1981, and this coming December he will have been missing for 20 years. Michael was studying at UCLA as a freshman on a music scholarship in the year of his disappearance, 1999. He was a popular student, he was known to have lots of friends, he was kind of very highly thought of, and he was known to be particularly kind of popular and well liked amongst the other students that he was living with in his kind of uni halls accommodation building. Michael had been living in an on-campus student accommodation, like I said, uni halls, and this halls in particular was called Dijkstra Hall. Apologise, I'll put the name on the screen, but this is kind of where the entire case takes place. On December the 10th, 1999, a bunch of the students, pretty much campus-wide students, were having like a celebration, they were partying, they were having fun with their fellow students before exams ensued, and then winter break followed the exams. So it was kind of like their last-ditch attempt before they would have to become studious and hardworking. So it was kind of like a campus-wide uproar of parties. And Michael was one of these students. So on this night, he had kind of been chilling with a bunch of his friends. He attended a bunch of different parties, like in his university accommodation with his friends. They kind of dotted about, seen some of their friends, had some fun basically. They were just drinking, playing some games, visiting some of the other friends, and just having a good time. In this accommodation building, Michael, as a lot of the other students did, had a roommate. So Michael and his friends, including his roommate, ended up back in Michael and the roommate's room, which is when his roommate went to bed and all of the other friends kind of gradually left. So Michael was pretty much the only one there. Michael and a friend of his who lived, I don't think he lived too far away, he was in the same building I'm pretty sure, just in a different room. So Michael and this friend in particular decided that they wanted to play a game and they wanted to play as a competition. So the other friend went to his own room and they decided to play this game against each other in their separate rooms. In the early hours of the morning, the pair finished their game, they ended it, and then Michael decided to leave his room after playing the game. In the early hours of the morning, the pair ended their game and Michael decided to leave his room to go to his friend's room, kind of just to congratulate him on winning the match that they'd been playing. And the pair then had a brief chat. They just chatted for a little bit, and because it was kind of early hours of the morning, I think it was around like 4 a.m, they decided to call it a night, and they both said goodnight to each other. The friend watched Michael head back to his own room, and after entering his room, this was the last time that Michael was seen. At around 9 a.m, Michael's roommate woke up to an empty room with no sign of Michael. All of Michael's belongings were still there, nothing had been moved, nothing had been taken, but there was no sign of him. And obviously at first this hadn't have appeared too concerning to the roommate, purely because, you know, they're in college, people have their own schedules, so he could have gotten up early, could be with a friend. There were so many explanations on why he might not have been in the bedroom at that time. But he did admit that he had found it initially a little bit strange that he would have been up and out of the room so early, considering how late he'd gone to bed. So, like I said, wasn't the most strange occurrence at first, but when they realised that they couldn't get hold of him, but after a few days had passed, I couldn't find like an exact timeline of when he was reported missing exactly. But when people realised that they kind of couldn't get a hold of him, presumably either his classmates, his roommate, or even his family, when no one could get in contact with him, they discovered that there was no sign of Michael past that night. When investigators were alerted of Michael's disappearance, him not being anywhere and no one really knowing where he was, they interviewed countless students who either lived in the accommodation hall that he lived in that night, or who may have been wandering through, may have been at a party, may have been staying at a friend's that night in the same building. People walking past, they interviewed so many students, but no one had seen any sign of him whatsoever. Allegedly, there had been a few witnesses who claimed to have seen someone looking like Michael leaving the building in early hours of the morning, but these were never confirmed, and it is possible that maybe they'd been mistaken, or maybe they were remembering incorrectly. There are so many things that could have provided an explanation for this, and it was kind of never really supported. But it does come up again at a later point in the investigation, so it's kind of worth considering. Search dogs were brought onto campus in hopes of finding any sign of maybe a journey that he had taken that day. They apparently had picked up a scent of Michael leaving the accommodation building that led them to a bus stop about a mile outside of the university campus. Theories have speculated perhaps why this might have been the case. Some people suggesting that maybe he had walked there and been picked up at the bus stop by some unknown party. But he'd left all of his belongings, like his wallet and everything, in his room. So it kind of poses more questions than it answers. And some people have said maybe the search dogs were just confused. He lives on this campus, so it could have been an older scent. It could have been a scent from earlier on in that day. It could have been anything. So there wasn't really any helpful discoveries because of this search. And no new advances came about from this case in the search until around 7 months later, when another student who was studying at UCLA, he placed a tip claiming to have seen a 35-year-old Caucasian man hovering around the accommodation building at the time of Michael's disappearance that night. His placement of this unknown man had been at 4:35 a.m, which would kind of match around the time after Michael was gone to bed. And as it turns out, this student had actually placed this tip when the initial investigation was going on, but local investigators, local law enforcement, hadn't really placed much thought into it. Obviously, they must have had a lot of tips and a lot of kind of things to follow in the initial investigation, and they just didn't seem any reason to follow it up, considering no one else claimed to have seen this man. But for some reason, 7 months later, this student's tip was heard, and they decided to follow up on it because obviously there had been no other developments. So the student was able to, even 7 months later, provide such a detailed description of this unknown man that they provided a composite sketch to all sort of public outlets. They put this man's face everywhere in hopes of identifying him and maybe finding some answers. However, to this day, there has been no tips or no leads on the identity of this unknown man known to be hovering around the accommodation building at this time. There have been a few theories sort of circulating regarding what could have happened to Michael on that fateful morning. One in particular originated from a post that Michael's brother had written, I think it was about 6 years ago now. He posted something online making claims that a lot of people have kind of agreed with ever since then. It sparked quite a few theories that I've seen kind of hovering about on Reddit. So Michael's brother, around 6 years ago, like I said, made a post claiming that Michael's friends had, during the initial investigation, admitted that Michael had started getting into a habit of using a lot of recreational party drugs. He'd suddenly found this interest in a lot of drugs, in particular ecstasy, and that, like I said, they had included this in the initial investigation, but the investigators hadn't really looked into it. They hadn't really considered any link between this and his disappearance. So like I said, it was ecstasy in particular that he was known to favour, and he had kind of found this new interest in going to raves, in which case kind of the two are usually linked. And so Michael's brother himself shared his belief that drugs were somehow involved in Michael's disappearance, whether it be some sort of accident that occurred because he had been on something, or perhaps he had gotten tied up with the wrong people because of drugs. I don't know, there's a lot of theories that have stemmed off of it, but it is an interesting thought. And like I said, it's quite a popular theory, a lot of people discussing the potential possibilities that arise from this sort of route. Another popular theory that seemed to kind of keep popping up while I was digging around on Reddit for some sort of theories was in relation to a family friend of Michael's, in particular a friend of his father's. His name was Damon Van Dam, and he allegedly, according to these theories, had arranged to meet up with Michael in that sort of time, so early hours of that morning when he disappeared. They'd allegedly made plans to go to something called a video game party, which I'm not entirely sure sort of what it's meant, but it is actually confirmed that he had been in the area at that time, so these theories do have some sort of factual basis. This theory mostly came about after a bunch of people decided that they believed that he bore quite a striking resemblance to the composite sketch that the student had released when they said that they'd seen this unknown man in the area at the time. So that is a potential theory that a lot of people have discussed. Some people have proposed that Michael could have fallen into, like, just a pure accident, fallen into an accident on a nearby construction site. Apparently there have been quite a few bit of construction work going on around the area, and it is possible that maybe in the night time, obviously it would have been quite dark, he could have potentially just wandered into one of these dangerous sites without realising and injured himself or gotten trapped somewhere where he couldn't alert help. However, many have argued that it is, one, highly unlikely for someone just to wander onto a dangerous construction site, since they're usually like fenced off, marked, kind of, especially at night times, they will be quite difficult to get into. Also, he would have likely known about the construction sites going on around where he was living, because obviously you know where they are. If you are living there, you know where the noise is coming from. And thirdly, it is also very, very unlikely that if this was the case, that something wouldn't have been found by now, there wouldn't have been any sign of him. So in all likelihood, during the initial search, in particular with the search dogs, they would have found some sign of him if this had been the case. As with a number of other cases that I've discussed on this channel, there is also a lot of talk and claims that there are deeper issues with the actual investigation itself. While many people who worked on the actual investigation did claim that it was handled as best as it could have been, you know, the police at the time did the best job as they could, there are still reports and claims of botched polygraph tests, incomplete searches, mishandled information. There's all of this sort of claims thrown about, and so it is entirely possible that there is some deeper sort of politically driven issue at hand here. So that's everything I have to discuss today, and let me know your thoughts down below. It's another one of these cases that are kind of frustrating because there really isn't anything to go on. It's another person that just seems to have vanished. So let me know your thoughts, whether there's one of these theories that you kind of clicked with in your mind, or if there's a different theory that you have. I'm always interested to hear. Thank you guys so much for watching. I hope you found this interesting, and I will see you guys soon for another video. Thanks for watching. Bye.